we're going to be doing some more practical stuff, but I have like a 5-minute presentation to get started, so you guys know what to do starting with. So I guess a bit about me to start with. My name's Danielle. I feel a bit fortunate being here because I'm a mobile developer. I'm not a JavaScript person, but I write apps. I've built, if any of you use Bootstrap, I built the Android equivalent of that 2 years ago, like this week, last week. And I've rebuilt like it to suit Google's material design, which has meant that I got quite popular quite quickly, unintentionally. And I got invited to go speak at DroidCon New York over the summer, which is great because they paid for me to fly over to New York. It was great to take the holiday. But I do teach JavaScript, so I teach in a couple of schools around Bath to teach the next generation coming up. So we teach our kids to build their own emojis using SVG, which is type of XML, you know, HTML type thing, and then make them interactive with JavaScript things. So she was sort of a year six girl. She made an emoji that the eyes were up and down on top of those. I thought it was quite cool. We also play around with these things, which are called LittleBits, and they're magnetic. It's like a Raspberry Pi, but magnetic, and you can connect them with the internet, and they actually work quite nicely. And you can then just connect the circuits up to make like cool things that you can do with it. We'll worry about that in a few minutes. I also run like a course at Bath College, so I've accidentally become a lecturer as well. I'm younger than like all of my students are in my course. That's kind of hilarious. So has everybody heard of the word Internet of Things? Has anybody not heard of the Internet of Things? Cool, who's not heard of Internet of Things? Great, I have a small presentation. The Internet of Things is connecting dumb things that weren't traditionally connected to the internet to the internet. So, for example, you connect a chronometer to the internet, like a telecom reception, or to compete with your friends. You can connect light switches or lights to the internet, so you can change the colour of them. You can set it so that if you're watching a movie, it dims and goes to the right colours at the right time. Lights weren't traditionally something that connected to the internet, so you know, it's a thing that's now connected to the internet. And then you've got this thing which is called Mother, which does like 93 million different things. So it attaches to things called cookies to things like toothbrushes, and it can determine if your children have brushed their teeth or not. And you can give them to the child, so you can determine if they've opened the door or not. You know, if they've left the house, you can determine who's in your house. So that's, you know, connecting everything to the internet. And then this is an example of a guy in Bristol that connected his toilet roll, obviously. So he could determine how much toilet paper he was using in his household and visualise it. So you can tell when people stayed, when it broke. You can work out when he had the flu. You can work out, you know, he was using a lot more toilet paper when he had the flu. But you could then plug that into like Amazon's API, and then you can work out, you know, when you're in toilet paper in quiet form. You know, you can use the trends and work out when you want to do things. So LittleBits have made a thing called the Cloud Bits, and you can connect with this with JavaScript and the Node API, and you can do cool things with it. So originally they want people to use if this then that, which is like a service that like simplifies all the things for you. LittleBits are like an educational platform. They want kids to be coming into technology and engineering and programming, but using if this then that doesn't really fix that problem. They do have an API, but it's not properly documented. Like I wrote an idiot's guide, which is a bit more popular. Google like documentation, little bits and cloud bits. Mine just comes up ahead of their official documentation because their documentation is not great. We've used it for kids already, so this was a hack that we did for the Festival of Code over summer. This was Max, who's 13. He connected 3 little bits to the Bath hat data for pollution, so that it determined how much, it could highlight how much pollution there was currently in Bath, and average it out so that other people can understand how big of an issue is pollution. And depending on what time of day, Bath can be quite bad, especially on like the main roads, which I thought was interesting. He did a good job. So he then, you know, programmed all using JavaScript. You can see you've got the 2 cloud bits at the bottom that he could send data to, if that makes sense. We're going to have a great example of like building an umbrella stand, so we can connect to the Yahoo weather forecast people. So they're people that like power the iPhone weather forecast. Like, I don't know if that shows. They do like the OSX one as well. So Yahoo basically feed everybody's weather forecast. So we can then make it so the little bits light up. You could then attach the little bits to an umbrella stand. It would remind you to take umbrella people. So it would automatically check if it's supposed to rain, light up if it's supposed to rain. I've got the example. examples working for you guys for that, you know, hopefully that won't take you the whole hour. I'd love it if you guys could come up with special examples with some other APIs that have like live data. If you get some, you know, stuff working, please tell me, because then we can use examples with children.
Right, so code. I'm going to run through this really quickly. I have a gist online which has got all the code in it, you copy paste to get something working. The idea is I'm just going to give you a quick overview as to what the code does, so you can then hopefully get started. So we're going to be using Node.js, which I guess is not a surprise to most people. So the app that we're going to be doing comprises of two parts. The first part is to get the data from, you know, Yahoo's LittleBits. We can then do the logic of, you know, the weather that's returned, is it supposed to rain tomorrow? If so, we can then post the data from LittleBits. So there are like two sections that we need to work on. The first bit is, so again, I've got a gist which has got all of the stuff you need on it. You need to install YQL, which is Yahoo's query language, and request, but that should have been in the GitHub documents. I hope you have it. It's a really simple npm install. Yeah?
I just wanted, is it just me? Or
that shouldn't be a problem. So all the LittleBits cannot connect to the internet here because there's a portal in the middle, so I've connected them all to my iPad. Hopefully the next time that the internet comes back up again, but I don't believe we could do it. If not, we can all try and connect to my iPad and see how much that complains. Like, I don't know what the maximum number of devices connected. I've got 8 LittleBits. Is that too much for my iPad already? I don't know. It's going to be a fun test. The other thing is LittleBits went down this morning, so they have like the fun of the internet of things. So they have your LittleBits, your device, the internet platform in the middle. If that bit in the middle goes down, you can't do anything with either of the bits. So there were internet-enabled locks and things that you can get into your house with your watch, you know, if you've got a smartwatch. That went down when the new iPhones were released, which meant that people that had it couldn't get into their houses. So it's the perils of like an internet platform. It's still, you know, they're still, hopefully the next time that the internet comes back up, I don't know if people are working on it. Do you know if people are working trying to get the internet back?
Yeah, they're on it.
Cool, they're on it. It'll be in 10 minutes. It'd be great. So again, you just need to install YQL and request. So they shouldn't take too long to download. It's small packages, I hope. So the first bit we're going to look at is posting data, because that at least you can make flashy lights and that motivates people to continue. So I don't know if anybody's ever used request, but it's basically sending a HTTP request. You have to set up the options. I'll go through all of these in a minute. So you have your posting data, so sort of getting data or sending data to where you want it to go. You have a specific URL. You have to be careful that you're sending it to the right cloud bit. I've named all of them after Pokemon, so if you don't know Pokemon, Google what the starter Pokemon are, the pictures will help you. Hopefully you have somebody that, you know, around you that knows what the Pokemon are and can assist you. If not, I'm here, I can assist you with what Pokemon are. No, so the Pokemon I've got, so that's for Oshawott that I've got here. I will show you in a minute how you copy that across over to the
Pokemon.
Not quite, I'll just explain it to you in a second. So this Pokemon number, you get it, so I will give you the credentials to log in as me on the LittleBits cloud platform. On the left hand side, you've got all the names of Pokemon. Yeah? So I've got Oshawott that I'm using. So you've got the name on the left hand side. You can click the big button. If you click the big button, it should then light up. So for example, here is the big button, here's my cloud bits. If I push the button, hopefully it should light up. As I'm lighting up, then if you swipe, I can send a specific value and it should light up with down. So you can then determine if your little bits are working or not. Mine are working because I'm using my iPad. But if I go back into that one, you've got a hidden button down the bottom called settings. If you click on that and you scroll all the way down, you've got a device ID, and that's the bit that connects to your particular device, if that makes sense. So you need the Pokemon name, because that's the one you've got, you need the device ID. You also need the access token, which is written underneath, which I've obscured because I uploaded the slide to the internet, and I didn't want everybody to be able to hack my little bits. So you need both of those are really super important. You can then send a body of like stuff, so you can send like the percent, so how much of your, you know, bar graph do you want to light up, and for how long do you want to light up. I think if you send it -1, it lights up forever, or until the next request comes in. So you can send, you know, percentage information. You also need to set two headers. The first of one says you're sending JSON data, the second of which is the authorization for the code, the ID and the access token, and it has to be in the format bearer and then XXX. So I've written an exclamation mark on that one.
You have to have the word bearer and then the access token. You can't just have the access token, which is very misleading in documentation. The other thing then you can add is a completion function. So you've got like a callback for what happens if it, you know, once your thing finishes. You can then check if there's an error. If there's an error, you probably want to log out what the error was. For the most part, it just says that it was all okay. That's good. It doesn't usually give you much more information than it's all okay. Then the final, most important thing is to actually send that request. So if you go to send request with the options of combine. I've then encapsulated it in a function called send request to the two LittleBits. And then I can customize the percentage that it lights up by. So that just makes it a reasonable function that I can use to test. The important thing is to remember to call that function, because you can think of functions if it doesn't run, and you spend hours working out why. So that should then light it up by a third. Right, the last bit is using the Yahoo database to get the weather forecast. So I don't know if anybody's used YQL or Yahoo's database weather forecast. Has anybody done SQL before? A lot of people done SQL. So it's almost identical to SQL, but they've changed the first letter to a Y for Yahoo. So this is, you know, good. If you ever need an SQL example, this is Yahoo are the people to go to. You know, so Yahoo have everything saved in where in the world IDs. So instead of being far off England, we're a random number of 6 digits long. But everywhere in England, or everywhere in the world, is a random number that they've assigned at some point. And you need to use their database to check what world ID you need. So for example, San Francisco, you can do select world, where in the world ID from their places database, or databases table, where text equals San Francisco. So if you want to Bath, you change that to Bath, England, or Bristol, England. And then it gives you some data in the middle. So you can select your SQL query in the middle. You can take whether you want it in XML or JSON. We probably want it in JSON for now, because you can read the XML data if you want. This is just for you to test what you're going to be getting. And then there's a big test button that you can press. You then get like a really tiny window of like the results that get taken back. So I'd recommend like copying that text into like a text editor so you can actually see, you know, navigate down the tree. It gives you a lot of crap to start with, like, you know, how much query you've got, you know, bits about the Yahoo database tables that you probably don't care about. It takes a while to get down to like the results section, and that's a super important bit. So again, this just selects where the world ID from GeoPlace to San Francisco. Those are the key points. You can then do that in a joined table. So they have a weather forecast table, so you can select the weather forecast from the weather forecast table. Where in the world ID from the inner SQL query that you've got. So hopefully that will then find you the weather for San Francisco. So it's just two SQL queries inside each other. If anyone's done SQL, that should be what you guys have done before. I've then changed that to be Bath, England, because I don't really care what the weather forecast is like in San Francisco. I'd rather know what it's like today. And then that should tell you, I don't know if you guys can see that, the forecast code, date, what the high, low, and then the text. You also get like a code. The unfortunate thing is, because Yahoo is American, everything comes in Fahrenheit to start with. So you have to add in a bit of code to say, I'm English, please give it to me in Celsius. And the U stands for units, and C stands for Celsius. So where units equal, and units equal Celsius. And then it changes everything to normal numbers that we kind of list out. So YQL, you can copy paste the SQL script that you've, or the SQL code you've got. You can post it into a YQL query, and it basically obscures, you know, getting the data and you get to get back. You can then just execute the function, check if there's an error, log out if there was an error, and then log out what results you've got. That's where you guys, this is where you guys will need to do the logic for testing if it's raining. So I'd recommend you can do regex on the text you get back, so you can text, you can test whether it's got the word rain in it, or you can have a look at the codes. So Yahoo does everything in weather codes, and it's got like a million different weather codes for different weathers. So you've got things like tropical storms, thunder, rain, you know, drizzle. The drizzle count as rain. You know, would you want to take an umbrella if it was drizzling out? It might rain later. Would you take an umbrella out if it was snowing? Whatever statements you want to have. I've then encapsulated that in a function again, just to make it slightly more reasonable. So that, you know, maybe you could add in where text equals, and you can allow people to customize where they get the weather forecast for. Or you could allow them to customize what day of the week they're looking for. up to you guys what you want to do next. And then, again, remember to actually call your function, because not calling it means that you won't get anywhere. And again, I've written all of that all of that stuff on a gist doc. So if you go to like my gist page, it should be the first one there, and you should be able to get it. Have we got the internet back? Is it working? No. Well, that was one worry. Well, hopefully we're connected in the next 5 minutes. I will hand out little bits. You guys can, so little bits are coloured. Orange, or rather we'll start, blue is power. Everything needs power to get started. Orange is logic, so the orange ones are cloud bits, the bits that you can program. You don't have to have a cloud bit to make a circuit. You could go for a pink thing is an input, the green thing is an output. So it's all colour coded. So if you have like a button connected to, and because it's magnetic, you can't connect it the wrong way, it just won't connect. You have to connect it, it snaps together. So now it doesn't fall off. So if I push a button, hopefully it will light up. So you guys, I've got different sensors. So I've got a bending sensor, so it tests when you bend things. I've got pressure sensors. You guys are working with it. I will hand out. So we're going to get into small groups of like 3 or 4. So I've only got 8 cloud bits, so there'll be 2 per row, if that makes sense. So you're going to have to get friendly with people next to you. Pair or work as a team, if that makes sense. So. Smartphones that they can like hotspot that way. Mm-hmm. You're welcome to get started that way. I already know how to see. You guys can get one. Yeah, I'll come back with USB cables in a second.
Cool. Here. I've never actually programmed in JavaScript before, so I'm probably not the best one to take the reins on this.
Yes.
A bright LED. Is that? That's a Wi-Fi, which is connected to